So what does it take to make a record in 2022? I'm going to give you as much information as I can about my process, and in the end of the video, get to the nitty-gritty of the actual numbers in my budget for making the new album we just tracked in Spain last week. Up until the early 2000s, I think there was this commonly accepted image surrounding the record industry, specifically that of the process a signed artist would go through in order to create music and build an audience. There were glamorous studios, big budgets, endless reels of tape, and quite often a team of 40 or more critical people involved in producing a record from start to finish, depending, of course, on the size of the project. As we all know, things have changed drastically since then, and anyone with access to a laptop computer and an internet connection is able to make music and build a fan base with which to share it. This can sometimes lead to mega hits, huge tours, millions of followers, and someone completely unknown being catapulted to stardom literally overnight. Those are kind of the two scenarios we know the most about, perhaps because they are the two scenarios most widely covered by media outlets, new and old, over the past 5 or 6 decades. The old being stuff like VH1's Behind the Music and Rolling Stone magazine, and the new, where you can see, you know, whatever artist you currently follow more than likely streaming their entire process on Twitch or Instagram Live. What I don't hear often discussed are the details of what it takes to have an old school process of going to a serious studio with great musicians, making music live together in the same room, and having an album launch and subsequent tour, with the new school framework of Instagram, TikTok, viral videos, and the internet in general. And for the purpose of this video, we're going to be looking at the status of recording music through the lens of improvised instrumental music, i.e. my new trio. No one seems to talk numbers or really break down the costs associated with this process, or how it might be possible to not only break even when you record music, but actually make a living from it again. And most importantly, without the horrendous recording contracts of the past, you know, where record labels would take 85%+ of everything you did in return for what? A recording budget and maybe some tour support. Or the horrific option available to artists today of giving all your music to Spotify or any number of streaming services for free, and actually in most cases paying to have your music placed there, making them a ton of money in subscriptions and ad revenue, and you getting literally nothing in return. Well, okay, maybe not literally, but we're talking minute fractions of a single cent whenever they use your music. Like I said before, I just returned from the studio in Spain where I was cutting a new solo record. I want to share the details of my process for making art that no one else really seems to talk about. Most people are ready to take your money via a crowdfunding platform like GoFundMe for a project that is dependent on hitting a financial goal before a note of music has been written or recorded or committed to. And I'm taking a slightly different approach to the process, and I'm going to share all the details with you in this video. First and foremost, I think the crowdfunding platform concept when it comes to recording music as an independent artist is kind of old, tired, and kind of a cop-out, actually. I think a lot of people ask themselves maybe all the wrong questions and set the wrong goals when they start the process of planning to record new music and present a project to their audience. I see lots of very well scripted announcements and pleas for funding based around a desire to go to some fancy studio or use a string quartet or hire in some producer that is really expensive. And what I rarely see in those cases is a track record of the artist or the group having made successful records before. I think it's kind of simple maths at the end of the day. If they had a successful track record, they more than likely wouldn't be scraping around for the bread to make the next one. You would think there would be some kind of rollover of momentum from previous outings to make the next vision a reality without having to ask the audience to make it happen. And if you don't have the experience or the money, that I think that's okay. There are so many cheaper solutions that don't involve, you know, East West Studio A with Quincy Jones producing and Chris Lord Algae mixing. I mean, if you really want to make music, you can do it for next to nothing now. And those restrictions in your budget should actually be the thing that makes you innovate and create something new because you have to. It's also kind of frustrating when you see artists who have more than enough money to spend a week with the London Symphony Orchestra if they wanted, but they're actually asking you for funding up front before they commit to their fusion quintet recording that will take no more than a couple of days to finish. That tells me they don't believe in what they're doing enough to risk the budget on making it happen. And that's why I want to change the way I do things when it comes to engaging with my audience, building trust in what I do, and creating great art. I know that there will be comments below about how valuable a platform like GoFundMe is for musicians because it potentially brings more value to the listener, that they feel more involved. There are perks you can offer them for participating early, and it can potentially widen an artist's audience by maybe being featured on the homepage of said platform. But this is where I have to highlight that not only is a platform like that a total security blanket for an artist, it's actually offering you nothing you can't do on your own. Yes, you can use their fancy drag and drop template to have a landing page to send your fans to, but your fans already know you. So why would you send them somewhere to give you money that GoFundMe, Kickstarter, or Indiegogo is going to take a cut of? All the fee structures for these platforms vary, of course, but all you're doing is adding a pointless link in the chain and paying off a middle entity for doing something you could do through your own website in less than 20 minutes. And my approach has been to do just that. Set up a pre-sale through my website, not a crowdfunding campaign, and offer massive value to the fans for being a part of the project before the album and documentary film come out on May 15th. And I have to be crystal clear that regardless of whether I sold one pre-sale item or 1,000, the album was always going to be made. I mean, admittedly, one pre-sale would probably eat a bit of a hole in my pocket considering what I had planned for this project, but that's my commitment to the art. It's also a measured goal in the sense that I know I have somewhat of an audience now. I was fairly certain that there wouldn't just be 10 sales and then I'd be on my own. And you know, spending the last 18 years putting out records as a bandleader has given me lots of useful information. And that's kind of what I based my choices on when it came to planning this project and trying to do something new with the process. All this to say, I value honesty in the process from the start to the finish. And to that end, let's talk numbers. I know that's probably more than likely why you clicked on the video in the first place, but I hope you leave here not just thinking about the numbers, but about how many more options there are without simply setting a financial goal that your project is dependent on hitting before it gets realized. I want you to have more respect for your own art if you're an artist, and if you're a fan of music, I really want you to better understand the pitfalls of what has become widely accepted as normal now in streaming platforms, and also how you can help artists you love by giving them support when they cut out the glossy middle people like Indiegogo and Kickstarter. It's all about honesty, trust, and communication, probably the three most essential ingredients for any relationship, this one being between artist and fan. So here's how my new project breaks down, and I'll do my best to remember every component that goes into the planning and execution. One thing I won't be able to share with you are the musician crew salaries. I think that's a very private thing for the individual musician, engineer, or crew member, and I hope you can understand and respect that. With freelance musicians, it's important to understand that most people negotiate their own rates, so throwing out simple union scale figures are not applicable here, especially with such a unique situation as this. I juggled a lot of factors when I was in the planning stages of this album. My musician Tom and Nico are in London and Paris. My engineer Juan Pablo is in Buenos Aires, and my film crew were coming from Denmark and Sweden. Now, that sounds like a crazy amount of money right away with all the moving parts, but as I break it down, you'll see it was actually cheaper for us all to go to Spain than it was to do it right here at home in Los Angeles. And not only that, but the studio we found, or rather the studio Juan Pablo found us, was something quite unique, and the experience it gave us was really completely priceless. That is a major factor for me when putting projects like this together, that the surroundings and environment are just as important as the musicians and the crew. Okay, so cue the money counter at the top of the screen and let's go. The round trip flights from Paris, London, Copenhagen, Los Angeles, and Buenos Aires were the biggest initial expenditure. Like I said, I can't go into the specific crew musician salaries, but let's say it didn't cost me nothing, but it also didn't cost me $20,000. I was able to negotiate around this being a creative project and not just a commercial jingle for a Ford truck or something. And also that this is a band and not just a one-off session. There will be live shows, more recordings, and lots more involved beyond these days in Spain last week. All factors worth considering whether you're negotiating to hire someone or negotiating for your own salary for a project. It's important to look at the overall value rather than the immediate situation. The studio, like I said, was a gem of a place to record. They were charging just 350 euros per day, and that included accommodation for up to 15 people. Now, that's 15 people, pretty cozy. We were seven and had more space than we needed. And there was a kitchen and all the amenities, a swimming pool. It was really, really quite a spectacular situation to relax and to work in for those 3 days. But there are things to factor into what seems like an insanely low daily cost for a studio. First of all, it's not in the center of a city. I had to rent a large passenger van at the airport to get the van to and from the location, which is roughly a 1 hour drive each way from Barcelona Airport. Once we were there, it is kind of in the middle of nowhere, so you have to do a couple of things in terms of keeping the crew fed and watered. Grocery runs totaled around 400 euros for the 3 days to keep the studio stocked, plus one lunch and two dinners at nice restaurants for seven people, which came in at around 440 euros. Now, considering the quality of the food and number of people, it's not a crazy bill, but I was covering all of that as part of the deal I had made with everyone. In order to transport all the pedals I wanted to the session, I needed a second Pelican 1510 rolling carry-on luggage, which came in at $307.60. And knowing we were filming the entire time, I didn't want to look a total mess, kind of like I do now, so I purchased some clothes specifically for the sessions. And then upon arrival, my luggage got lost and I had to spend the first day in the same clothes I flew 30 hours in. You'll see it in the documentary. It was, let's just say, less than optimal. Airport parking at Los Angeles International Airport is not cheap and is yet another annoying little extra that has to be considered in the budget. And now that we have a six-month-old child at home, leaving town for any length of time requires a nanny at home to take some of the workload off of Chelsea, who is also has her own career and is working nonstop these days. Costs, as of the making of this video, that have yet to be added to the budget include those of mixing and mastering the album and also having a professional colorist work on the final cut of the documentary film. I anticipate those costs running somewhere in the $2,000 to $3,000 range once all is said and done. They may well be initially much less, but I always work on the assumption that things are going to need to be revised, changed, edited, and generally need more hours of work than initially planned. So this is the rough working total, not including the specific musician crew salaries, but a total of what it takes to put a project like this together and get it out there into the world. And as of the making of this video, 185 people had purchased one of the five levels of the pre-sale. That by no means puts me into any kind of profit and still leaves me somewhat short of what it will take to break even. But let's remember, the album isn't out yet. It's not even finished, and that's where we're at. My entire catalog of 12 previous albums did less than $1,800 in digital streaming revenue in all of 2021. I have never broken even on an album ever. So this is a success before it's even finished, and you are a huge part of that. The continued support I experience through all of my artistic endeavors does not go unnoticed or unappreciated. I want to build on this newer concept of fan involvement without crowdfunding and create even more trust in what I do and grow further to be able to bring even more value to you as a listener, and as a byproduct, a little more happiness to me as an artist and allow me to be creative and have that space to do what I think I probably do the best. The five levels of the pre-sale at my website are just the beginning. Once the album is out, the live experience can begin to be shaped and developed, and that is something I'm just so excited about. If you're an artist and you truly believe in what you're doing, there is nothing that can stand in your way of making it a reality. Believe in yourself and your fans and supporters will believe in you too. Please leave your comments and questions below, and I hope to meet some of you out on the road as I present this new trio to you.